Hello friends, I'm going to do my best today to create a new model of reality for you and a framework for you to understand that the real you can influence and participate in changing the biofields, the electromagnetic fields and the quantum fields that are at the heart of all activity in the universe, and therefore the real you can actually influence and revise what we call reality, the reality that we observe as mind, body, and universe. So perhaps you have heard a new term that is being popularized right now in science. And the term is electrome, E-L-E-C-T-R-O-M-E. And it refers to the entire electrical system of a living organism, including our own biology, but all living organisms, including plants, animals, etc., even microbes. This means that the electrome encompasses all the electrical currents within your body at the cellular level, all the way up to the organism. So starting with the cellular level, all the way up to the organism as seen with our perceptual activity. Think of it this way. Our DNA makes up our genome, and all the proteins in our body are part of what we call the proteome. The electrome uses a similar concept to describe the totality of electrical activity. This electrical activity is essential for life. Our nerves use electrical signals to transmit messages, but it goes beyond that. The electrome is involved in cellular development, healing, and even how we age. The study of the electrome is a growing field, and scientists are only beginning to understand its full potential. It may hold the key to future medical treatments and technologies. So, this new finding poses strong arguments to be made that the body, mind, and the experience of the world are a unified experience in awareness, with the electrome as the mediating mechanism. And here are some of the current approaches being studied. Number one, embodied cognition. This field of psychology emphasizes the role of the body in shaping thought and perception. Our bodies are not just vessels for our minds, but active participants in how we understand the world. In a previous post, I mentioned that you can think of the body as a sensor and also as a way to organize motor activity. So sensory activity and motor activity are part of a feedback loop. So the way we move our bodies, for example, can influence our emotions and even our cognitive abilities. There's also something called the biopsychosocial model. And this model in medicine recognizes the complexity of the interplay between biological, psychological, and social factors in health and illness. It highlights that these factors are not separate, but interconnected and influence each other. Then there is something called the whole field of phenomenology. This philosophical school of thought focuses on the lived experience of the world. It argues that the mind and body are not distinct entities, but rather two aspects of a unified experience of being in the world. And of course, you're familiar with my favorite topics in Vedanta, Kashmir Shaivism, and Buddhism, where these traditions view the mind-body as a single whole or a unified process, along with the perceptual activity that we call the world. And these philosophies emphasize practices like meditation to cultivate a more integrated sense of the self and the world. So the idea of a unified awareness does recognize the distinctions we make between mind and body. We can separate them conceptually, although in reality, they are a unified process. Imagine a wave. While we can describe the wave as the movement of water molecules, the experience of a wave is a unified phenomenon. Similarly, body, mind, and experience of the world might appear to be distinct parts and separate activities, but they're actually activities of a larger process of what we call being aware. Now, let's go a little further. As you know, our body, now the activity of the electrode influences what we call the biofield of the body. So attention and intention and even what you're interested in are heavily influenced by electrical activity in the brain. So let's go over some points. Our nervous system relies on electrical signals for everything it does. Sensory information travels as electrical impulses through nerves, and motor commands activate muscles via similar signals. Attention, intention, and interest involve focusing on specific things in our environment or what we are interested in. This focus requires brain regions to be more active, processing incoming information or preparing for a specific action. Today, brain imaging techniques like EEG, electroencephalography, measure electrical activity in the brain. And studies show distinct EEG patterns when people are paying attention or are interested in something compared to being just bored or unfocused. Specific brain areas like the reticular activating system are crucial for alertness and attention. These areas use electrical signals to modulate overall brain activity, directing our focus. So while electrical activity is a key player, attention and interest are complex processes. Emotions, memories, and physical states, whether you're sleeping, dreaming, or awake, but even what you're interested in when you're awake changes electrical activity and brain activity and biological activity and gene activity. So electrical signals in nerves translates directly to the brain. Attention and interest rely on specific electrical patterns and activity in different brain regions. So brain activity is changed through attention, intention, and body and awareness are also influenced simultaneously. Your state of awareness influences arousal. When you're awake and alert, your heart rate, breathing, and muscle tension are higher compared to sleep. Hormones change in these states. Changes in awareness can trigger hormonal shifts. For example, melatonin production increases in preparation for sleep, and cortisol levels arise with alertness. There is increasing activity that awareness can influence gene expression, and genes play an important and significant role in shaping our baseline brain activity. And so back and forth, feedback from the genes to the brain, brain to the genes. So what does this all mean? Well, the electromagnetic field pervades all of the universe, and it is one aspect of the quantum field. The quantum field is the most fundamental field defined by science, and the quantum field is not passive. It is bubbling with the appearance and disappearance of what we call virtual particles, which are the field itself fluctuating as determined by the uncertainty principle. In other words, the electromagnetic field, which is an expression of the quantum field, one aspect of the quantum field, is pervasive across the universe, but also inside our body, influencing everything. Now, I've mentioned to you that this electromagnetic field is an aspect of the quantum field. And now I'm going to come to the final conclusion, which is awareness or the consciousness field is even more fundamental. It is what is modifying itself as the quantum field, and then also the electromagnetic field. This is very obvious in every action that we perform. I raise my hand, starts with the consciousness field, translates into the electromagnetic field, which is an aspect of the quantum field. I don't see how anyone can argue this. You know, the mainstream science does not connect awareness field or consciousness field, which in Eastern wisdom traditions is also an Akashic field, the Akashic field being one aspect of the infinite consciousness field, which is literally infinite, therefore incomprehensible and unimaginable and formless and spaceless and timeless, modifying itself. Why? In order to have experience. So it's modifying itself as the quantum field, the electromagnetic field, the electrome activity in the brain, activity in the body, activity in genes. So it's going to take a while, but mainstream science has to recognize that there is a consciousness field that knows itself as what humans model as the quantum and electromagnetic fields, and ultimately the electrome that governs the activity of our body, but all of that influenced by consciousness knowing itself as that. That consciousness is non-local. It is not the personal property of anyone, and it is what contains and engulfs all the universe. But it is a field which is aware of itself. Again, going back to chapter 13, Bhagavad Gita, I am the field, I am the knower of the field. So the field knows itself as mind, body, universe, as a unified process. But because we have the ability to transcend beyond the conditioned mind and act from there, as in Sanyama, Dharana, Dhyana, Samadhi, we have the ability to shift the activity of the quantum field, the electromagnetic field, the electrome, and therefore revise our experience of the mind, brain, genome, perception, and experience of the world. We experience the human universe filtered through the conditioned mind, but behind the conditioned mind is an unconditioned field of infinite possibilities, infinite correlation, infinite evolution, infinite creativity, and also uncertainty and imagination. It is the field that imagines itself as the universe through different species, and the highest expression is the human species, because it has the ability to know itself as the field beyond the conditioned mind. So everything we call reality is subject to revision. If we can go back to the source of all experience and practice sanyama, dharana, focused awareness, attention and intention, dhyan, meditation, samadhi, resolution of subject-object split. So, once again, this leads to only one conclusion. You are the universe. Aham Brahmasmi. You are Brahman, and your expression is Brahmand, the total universe, and maybe even multiple universes.